hear the cry that they have, hear their heart, feel their heart. And it's for you and I. You know what? It's for you and I to receive that. You know what? I hear Sister Veronica, Sister Dorothy, and Sister Serena when they're up here, Sister Nance when she's up here at times. I hear their hearts. You know what? It's a heart filled with gratitude and gratefulness for what God has done in their lives. And they want you to know that they're up here singing unto the Lord to help usher him, his spirit in for you and I. Amen? Amen. I just want to say good morning, good afternoon to all that are watching us via Facebook, Praise Chapel Revival, Oxnard, our app, and also on Facebook. We welcome you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. So let's give them all those that are watching. Let's give them a hand of praise. Amen. For joining us. Amen. We appreciate that you're joining us, but we'd love it if you'd be here with us. Amen. That way we may embrace you and demonstrate the love of Christ to you. Amen. So if you're watching us, just know that we're doing everything that's called upon us by the state to make ensure safety. But come. Share the word with us, share the love, and you know what, share an embrace with us, amen. So we welcome you, amen. Let me ask this question, are there any grouches in the house today? Any grouches that are mad because they lost an hour of sleep? I know there's some people that don't age, you know what? 1 hour's a, you know what, hey. But amen, we're thankful and grateful that you're here. We're thankful and grateful for Brother Abel sending out a text to the men, you know what, reminding us to be here an hour early. But you know what, thank you for making it here, you know what. Praise God. I know that God's going to do something special today. If you came hungry, is anybody hungry today? You know, the Word of God says in John that he is the bread of life. The bread of life. So if you came hungry, the bread of life is going to fulfill you today. It's going to nourish you and strengthen you, give you us what we need for this day. Amen. You know that our pastor has been in deep prayer. And you know what? And since we've been back services here, it's been life changing, not only for me. I leave different. I know I leave different and there's a more pep in my step, amen? There's more pep in my step because I know who I am in Christ, amen? And you know what, and hey, you know what? So, brothers and sisters, don't just come, you know what? Just come. Come to hear. Come to be transformed by the word, amen? Come to, you know what? Even in church, there's backsliders. We got to surrender our hearts, amen, unto the Lord. Let him work in our hearts, in our hearts. You know, the word of God tells us, they honor me with their, but their heart far from me. So let's surrender our hearts to him today. You know what? Just let him break that heart of stone and make it a heart of flesh. Amen? Yeah. Amen. I just want to remind everybody that we have the basket back there for it's going to be raffled off next week, next weekend, I believe. Next weekend, amen. And there's a big old list of everything's on that's in there, but just has a RCA tablet, some journals. How many like candy? It has candy in there if you want candy. Some gift cards, Amazon, Taco Bell, eBay, Chick-fil-A, Starbucks, $2.25 Starbucks. I know people line up for Starbucks. A $50 Visa gift card, some hands-free Bluetooth. There's all kinds of stuff in here. So over a $500 value. So the tickets are $5 each or 5 for 20, amen. So, and all that goes to support the event committee. I forgot the word, amen. The event committee. So all that goes to support the event committee, amen. As they put their hands to the plow to plan out, you know what, things for this upcoming year. Amen? Amen. So I just want to let everybody know that our building fund is at $30,160. Amen? So thank you all to those who are contributing, who are being faithful to that. You know, the Word of God says he is faithful. You know what? So Let us continue to be as faithful as we can. Amen. And now for our tithes and offerings. If you need an envelope, please hold up your hands. The ushers will get you a tithing envelope. Amen. Hallelujah. And we're going to go to the book of Proverbs, chapter 11. We're going to read three verses, 24, 25, and 28. Proverbs 11, 24, 25, and then verse 28. If you have your Bibles, would you turn there? And if you're able to stand, please stand with us as we partake of God's holy word. Amen. Hallelujah. The word of God says in Proverbs 11, verses 24, 25, and then verse 28, there is one who scatters, yet increases more, and there is one who withholds more than is right, but it leads to poverty. The generous soul will be made rich, and he who waters will also be watered himself. Verse 28 says, he who trusts in his riches will fall, but the righteous will flourish like foliage. Amen. So with that being said, let's come forth and bring our tithes and offerings. Amen. Let's hold up these baskets and let's stretch forth our hands towards these baskets. Amen. Father in heaven, Lord, we thank you for your grace and your mercy, my God. We thank you that you love us so much, my God, that you would send your son Jesus to hang on that old rugged cross for sinners such as us, my God. That's how much you love us, my God. Thank you, Lord, that we are able to sow a seed back into the kingdom, my God. For everything that we have comes from you, my God. Lord, help us to remember the promises, the vows, the commitments we have made unto you, my God. Help us to be faithful unto you, for you are a faithful God, my God. Lord, we just ask that you would use these tithes for the furtherance of your kingdom, my God. That they would go out to the highways and the byways, my God. To those dark places, to the prisons, my God. To those places where we once were, my God. Lost in darkness, but your light, your marvelous light shone through, my God, and reached us and touched us, my God, and brought us out, my God. Thank you for loving us, my God, the unlovable, for having hope in us when we were hopeless, my God, for putting trust in us when we couldn't be trusted with nothing, my God. Lord, we thank you, my God, and we give you all praise, all glory and honor, and the church of God says, amen and amen. Let's give the Lord our big clap offering. Amen, please. As we get ready to prepare for today's service, you know, it's good to see Brother Andy. Many of you might have heard this morning he had a spider bite and he was in the emergency, amen, emergency room, but he made it to service, amen. So welcome, brother. We're glad you're here, amen. We're praying that all is well, amen. I told my mom, I called my mom, and I was on the phone actually with my mom, and I told her that Brother Andrew was in the ER, and she sent out a prayer request for him because my mom knows Pastor Mondo and from way back, amen. So anyway, but we're glad that you're here. I just want to ask you to keep one another in prayer. Sister Susan and her family, she took the shot, and I think she's a little bit under the weather, so, you know, just keep all those in prayer. But you know what, if you look around, you know where everybody sits, right? do yourself and do the church a favor, you know, and do them a favor by calling them and let them know that they missed out. They missed out. You know, take time to text them. You know what? Text is, I think, so impersonal. I think a phone call is the way to go. That way you can actually hear their voice, you know what? So I encourage, if you have a time, a moment, reach out to someone, call them, let them know that you missed them. And if they ask you what the service was about, tell them you should have been there. You should have been there. You should have been there. But come on now, but we got a lot of brothers and sisters that we know where they sit that are not here today for whatever reason. You know, sometimes they're struggling, and you know what? They just need someone to let them know that someone cares about them. So let us be that person. I know I can remember when I would miss a service, people would reach out to me, and I felt they were so appreciative of that know that people care about you and people love you. So let us have that same, amen? Amen. With that being said, let's put our hands together and let's welcome our pastor up as he comes, amen?
Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Can you hear me? Praise the Lord. Good to be in the house of God. Amen. A little quiet in the house of God. Amen. I believe God is going to do great and mighty things today. I believe this is what God has given me. This is going to be a healing service. Amen. Not only for those that are here, but those that are watching online. I truly believe that. I believe God is going to. We take for granted the word of God, and we testify and we believe that He is our healer, and that He is a miracle working God. Amen. So let's step out in faith. And those of you that need a healing today, whatever it may be, physical, mental, spiritual, I believe God is going to grant that for you today, if you believe. The key is if you believe. Amen. I want to thank all those, the tithers and those that are given to the ministry. I want to thank you for continued support for the ministry, and may God continue to bless you. Amen. Abundantly. And I just thank God for you. And those that are watching online, you can give at praisechapelrevival.com. You can click on the top left-hand side there. You can navigate there and you can give digitally. Amen. Tithes and their offering through there. Amen. Well, also, I want to extend a prayer to those that have received the vaccination, and maybe they got a negative response to that. We're going to pray for healing also for those that are not able to be here physically, but we're going to extend that. Amen. We're going to ask Jesus to move in a miraculous way to heal them for whatever it is they're going through. Amen. I want you to join me in that today. Glory to God. Well, with no further ado, let's open up our Bibles to the book of John. The book of John, chapter 1. Hallelujah. The Gospel of John, should I say. The Gospel of John, chapter 1. Took down the clock, huh? Whoa. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Everybody there say amen. Amen. Gospel of John. Not John the Baptist, but John. Amen. The Revelator. Chapter 1, verse 43. The Bible says, the following day, Jesus wanted to go to Galilee. And he found Philip and he said to him, follow me. Now Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and he said to him, we have found him of whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph. And Nathanael said to him, can anything good come out of Nazareth? Philip said to him, come and see. Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him and said of him, behold, an Israelite indeed, in whom is no deceit. Verse 48 says, Nathanael said to him, How do you know me? Jesus answered and said to him, before Philip called you, you were under the fig tree. I saw you. Nathanael answered and said to him, Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel. Jesus answered and said to him, because I said to you, I saw you under a fig tree, do you believe? You will see greater things than these. And he said to him, most assuredly, I say to you, hereafter, you shall see heaven open and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you, Lord, for the opportunity, Lord, to come to you, Lord, with boldness, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that he who the Son sets free is free indeed. We ask for freedom in this house, in this place, in this sanctuary, God. Over those that are watching, God, we pray, God, and we believe with them, Lord, for a supernatural breakthrough, Lord, today. In Jesus' name, Lord, we come one mind, one accord. Your word says where two or more are gathered in your name, you're in the midst. You're here. You're ready to do the impossible, God. What is possible with man or impossible with man is possible with you, Lord. And for that, we take you at your word. And all the saints of God say, amen and amen. Let's give the Lord a hand of praise. Hallelujah. Well, they took out the clock. Praise God. No limit. Amen. In John chapter 1 and verses 43 through 51, that's a powerful portion of scripture right there. That's a lot of meat to chew on. But many people often ask, why are there four gospels? Why does the Bible contain four stories of the life of Jesus Christ? And when we read the gospels of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, there's another question that is asked, is why are they so different? If all four writers are writing about the same story or the same person, why does it seem that there's differences in the same story? One thing is each writer is addressing a different group of people. They're writing to different congregations and different communities. And what they write and how they write is directly impacted in their writing. You see, Matthew writes to a predominantly Jewish audience, and Luke to a Gentile crowd. And they flavor to the story of Jesus differently based on who they are interacting or who they are addressing. Also, we must remember that after the death of Jesus, there was no immediate urgency to write it down on paper. Because the original disciples, they believed that Jesus would be back before they died. And so rather than writing the story or the history on Jesus, the story and the life of Jesus was orally transmitted. So that means that it was talked about. It means that it was shared in a conversation with amongst people. We're talking about it amongst themselves, about what Jesus did and the miracles that he performed, his death and his resurrection. But after about 40 years, it became apparent that Jesus was not coming back as soon as they thought he was. Thank you, brother. And so about 40 years after, Mark, the first gospel writer, sits down and he puts the life of Jesus on paper. Because you and I both know what happens when we put it out there orally. Everybody knows what happens. You begin to share it in conversation. The longer the conversation stays out there, the more details are added to it. So the gospel writers wanted to solidify the life of Jesus so that generations of Christians had it so that they could be verified on the account of the life of Jesus. So they're sitting down writing under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit and putting it on paper. And one of the things John lets us know that in John chapter 20 is that everything that Jesus did is not written in the Gospels. That there is no way to contain everything that the Lord does. As a matter of fact, if you read the last verse in the last chapter of John, John declared that there's no way for any book that contain everything that Jesus did. And if you get that, then you know that every author then is selecting or selectively choosing what stories to write about Jesus. Matthew, writing to a Jewish crowd, he pulls the stories of Jesus with some Judaic tone so that the Jewish crowd would understand that the Messiah, Jesus, who Moses and the prophets spoke about, they would know that he was the Messiah. Luke pulls down stories that he shares with the Gentile crowd to let them know that the Gospels are not only locked in or limited to the Jews, but that Jesus was intentional about Gentiles, that they could freely come in and accept and enter into the kingdom of God. And Mark pulls down the actives or the actions of Jesus. He leaves out the speeches of Jesus in the book of Mark, not by what he says, but by what Jesus does. Because we know that action speaks louder than words. And then there's John. John says in chapter 20, everything I'm writing so that you may believe. And if you believe in Jesus, you can have life in his name. That's what the scripture says. Believing is at the core of the gospel of John. So when you go home and you read chapters 1 through 21, you want to underline every time that you come across the word believe. And you will find that John makes reference of the word believe 98 times in the Gospel of John. And it is whether you believe that or not, that Jesus is a Christ means everything. Matter of fact, he lays it all on in chapter 1 in verses 11 and 12. The Bible says that he came to his own, but his own did not receive him. But as many as received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God. To those who believe in his name, and those two verses are really the table of contents for the rest of the Gospel of John. Page after page, scene after scene, the Gospel of John focuses on scenarios where Jesus interacts with somebody or different people, and the question is, do you now believe? That's what Jesus asks through the questions in John, or that's what John references Jesus asking. He raises the dead and he asks, do you believe? He feeds the 5,000 and he says, is that enough for you to believe and to trust me? He heals the blind. And he allows them to see, and he asks them, do you believe that I am the Christ? As a matter of fact, you can't get out of chapter 1 without the question of belief. It's all right in your face in chapter 1. It's the question of believing in discipleship. This is big. Watch how the story goes. Jesus is walking in Galilee, and one day he passes John the Baptist. You know the story. For sake of time, I'm going to paraphrase. And John tells his followers, that's the Lamb of God. Behold, that is the Lamb of God that I was telling you about. The Bible says that two of his disciples of John now began to follow Jesus. And Andrew is so amazed about this Jesus that Andrew says, I can't keep it to myself. He runs and he gets his brother named Simon. We know him as Peter. He says, okay, follow me. This is what Jesus says. Now I have two disciples. And then he found Peter or Philip walking, and he says to Philip, follow me. And Philip says, yes, Lord. Because Philip sees Andrew and Peter, which are from his hometown, you can call them his homeboys. He sees him following Jesus, and he's so amazed with Jesus that Philip goes and he gets Nathanael. And Nathanael, I want you to see this. Andrew got Peter. Peter got Philip. Philip got Nathanael, because anytime you really believe or you love the Lord, you're not going to keep this content to yourself. If you really believe and you believe that Jesus is the Christ and he worked a miracle in your life, you cannot help but to contain it to yourself. The Bible says that it was like shot up in my bones. I had to tell somebody. So Philip goes and he gets Nathanael and he says, we have found the Christ, the one they have been written about in the Word of God. His name is Jesus. He's the son of Joseph, and he's from Nazareth, which is right around the corner. And Nathanael said to him, you know the phrase, can anything good come out of Nazareth? Can anything good? Can anything good come out of El Rio? Can anything good? And Nathanael doubts, and in order to become a disciple of Christ, there must be some things that you have to believe. Are you hearing me? And when you read this text, it's tailored to teach us what disciples need to believe. That if you're going to follow the Lord, if you're going to claim Jesus as the Lord and Savior of your life, if you're going to come to church every Sunday, if you're going to carry your Bible and your cross, if you're going to get a tattoo with Jesus on your neck, no, don't do that. If you're going to follow Jesus, you got to believe. You got to believe. If you're going to follow the Lord, here's what you got to believe. The first thing the text teaches us is that if you follow Jesus, you got to believe what God said. I said, if you follow Jesus, you got to believe what God says. And you got to believe what God says that you're going to see. Let me say that again. You got to believe that what God says that you're going to see that. You got to believe that if you're going to be a disciple of God, God's going to show you that. Do you believe that? Whatever God promised, God's going to personally show you. If God has promised, he's not one to break his promise. So I got a witness in this place. God does not waste his words telling you that he's going to do something that he's not going to do. That's not the God we serve. You can't even get out of Genesis before God says, let it be. Let there be light. God speaks. God's going to do it. If he says he's going to do it, he's going to do it. Watch this. Philip says to Nathanael, listen. Listen. Jesus says, is it? He is the one written about in the Word of God. But the Bible says that Nathanael doesn't believe. So Philip's answer is, well, come and see with your own eyes. Come and see. Because when you find it hard to believe what you heard, God will set up a scenario for you to see what he said he's going to do. He's going to set it up. Do you believe that? Because if there's truth be told, there's some moment in life when it's hard to believe. It's hard to believe God is going to come through in your life. It's gotten so bad that people stand against you when you believe in this kind of stuff. It's hard to believe when people say it's going to work together for the good. It's hard to believe that. It's hard to believe sometimes. But you got to believe that. It's hard to believe that God is going to turn a situation around. It's hard to believe that. And God says, whenever you doubt what I said, I'm going to show you. I'm going to show you. And that's what he does with Nathanael. That I could do what I said I'm going to do. We got to trust God at his word. Brothers and sisters, that's why you ought to read your Bible. That's why you got to read your Bible. So that you know what God said. I saw a post which I enjoyed last week, and it was someone that was kneeling down and praying. Maybe some of you saw that. And it was a man illustrated that he was praying to God. And then on the right-hand side, it had a Bible. That meant God was speaking to him by the word of God. So that you can know what God says. And every time you read your Bible, you know what it's like. It's like going to a movie. Some people like reading, but they stay away from the Bible. It's amazing, because the Bible's the greatest book ever wrote. Number one bestseller. You've heard me say that, but the least read. But when you read your Bible, it's like going to a movie. And you're going because you paid for it, right? You paid for that movie. And it's a blessing if you get there early, because you see little sneak previews of different movies. And you'll never be able to see the thing is, you'll never be able to see the previews unless the production is done. Are you with me? Unless the movie's already done. The movie's already been filmed. The script has already been laid. The actors already been in. They've already been called. And you'll never see the previews without there being a production. That's why we ought to read our Bibles. Because God will work all things together for the good. He will that. Those that wait on the Lord, they shall renew their strength. We got to believe that. We got every promise that God makes in our lives. We got to believe that. But now what I'm going to say is going to make some people quiet. Watch the text. Nathanael doubts. Philip says, come and see. He invites Nathanael to come and see the word that has been fulfilled in Jesus. Philip invites Nathanael to see that God has done what he said he was going to do. But you got to see that in somebody first before it happens to you. Generally, you got to see Jesus in somebody first before it happens to you. That's God's invitation to see how God works, is not first to reveal in your life. It's revealed in seeing someone else's life being touched. I wish I had a witness. That's why you need to come to church. I said, that's why you need to come to church. That's why you need a church home. That's why it's so critical. So that when life gets rough, and it will, and you know it will, you begin to doubt the word of God. You begin to doubt God is going to do what he said he's going to do. That ain't the Sunday to stay home. When you begin to doubt, that's the Sunday that you ought to push yourself to get to church. Come on, somebody. So that you can see for yourself what God is doing in the house of God. So when your pastor gets all excited and gets to the point of that sermon, and he said, is there anybody in this place that can testify about the goodness of God? I said, is there anybody in this place that can testify that God has pulled you from a situation that you never thought that you could come out of? This whole place ought to be jumping. God is able to do the miraculous in our lives. The Bible says that he calls out to the things that are not as though they were. That's not the pastor trying to manipulate your praise. He's giving you evidence that God is a miracle working God. And that what he's done for somebody else, and we heard it today, he can do it for you. God can touch your family where you think nobody else can. God will use somebody else you've been trying to minister for years. That's just how God works. What God said he was going to do, he's going to do. We know that God answers prayer. We know that he delivers us from the storm. He heals our bodies. So when we see people bearing witness about what God does or what God has done, don't let it anger you. Let it excite you. Don't ever get comfortable with God. Don't ever get comfortable with the movement of God. God is alive. Jesus is alive. Don't ever forget what God has done for your life. Don't ever let that become the normal. Always remember, always keep fresh what God has done in your life. And he's not done. That's the good part. I want you to believe that what he said God is going to do for your life. You need to know that the Lord knows everything about you. You got to know that. You got to know that the Lord knows everything about you. There's nothing about you that the Lord doesn't know. Nathanael was walking toward Jesus, and Jesus said, "Behold, an Israelite, indeed, whom there is no deceit." No matter how hard we try to hide it, the Lord knows everything about us. No matter how much makeup we put on or the facade we try to put on, God knows everything about us. The Lord sees everything. The Lord knows what's in your heart. The Lord knows what's in your head. The Lord knows what keeps you up at night. The Lord knows all. The Lord knows your pain. The Lord knows the enemy all around you. The Lord knows everything. The Lord knows what you're tempted by. The Lord knows your weakness. The Lord knows exactly what you need. But do you believe? He knows what makes us angry. He knows what bothers us. The Lord knows everything about it, about us. Now, if you get that, I got some good news and some bad news. I said, I got some good news and I got some bad news. Here's the bad news. The Lord knows everything about you. The Lord knows when you're holy. The Lord knows when you're sinful. The Lord knows when you're righteous. The Lord knows when you're wretched. I got a witness. The Lord knows everything about you. Which is why it really doesn't make sense that we don't confess our sins to the Lord. Because the Lord knows anyway. He knows everything. You want the good news? Here's the good news. The Lord knows everything about you. That's the good news. But watch this. He knows everything about you, and he still calls you anyway. The Lord knows everything you've done, and he still says, "Follow me." What an amazing God we have. He still loves us anyway. That's amazing. People reject you on the basis of who they think you are. But God knows who you are. He knows everything about you. And he still accepts you. That's amazing. When people don't want to have anything to do with you, that don't even know you, God says he loves you. I don't know why God does that. I don't understand why that. Everything we failed in, and he still loves us. Everything that we didn't complete, it's amazing. And he still loves us anyway. He knows me, and he still loves me. Amazing. God, I don't know why you love me, but he loves us. I can't comprehend it. I'm complicated. I'm sinful. And he still loves me. Amazing. That's the God we serve. God loved you in spite of everything you've done. In spite of everything. Is there anybody here? I said, is there anybody here that's grateful to have a God that loves you? He loves you and I believe that. We got to believe that. And I believe that we will see what he said he's going to do. You got to believe that. In closing, short message today. You can get your grub on early. Watch this. He said to Nathanael, you believe simply because I told you. You got to catch this. I saw you under the fig tree. Watch what Jesus said. He said, boy, you haven't seen anything yet. Come on. You haven't seen nothing yet. Because I want you to believe that greater things are yet to come. Hallelujah. We got one praise. He said, I'm going to want you to know that great, you're going to see greater things. For all you Bible theologians, he said, you're going to see greater things than this. I'm saying greater things are yet to come. If you believe that. They're on their way. The word of God says they're on their way. I don't know who this is for, but you know. You know the word of God that is speaking to your life. Because you already feel it. The Holy Ghost has infiltrated. Because one of the saddest things is to sit in the sanctuary and have no hope. To get caught up in a dark moment, which is for a season. And then to forget or to cancel out the hope that we have. To give into darkness, which is a temporary thing. Believing that nothing better can come our way. That's the saddest thing. This is not the last chapter of your life. It doesn't end right here. This is not your final destination. The story's not over. Jesus is alive. God is not finished with you yet. Come on. No eye has seen or no ear has heard what God has in store for those. Nobody knows. It hasn't even entered into our mind what God has in store for you and I. Greater things are yet to come. Hallelujah. I said, greater things are yet to come. Are you ready for what God is about to do? I said, are you ready? It's better than what God has already done. God's next is better than God's last. You got to believe that. Is there anybody in this place that believes that? That believes God at his word, that God ain't finished with me yet? Do you believe that? Is there anybody here that believes that? That God has more in store. You got to believe that. I want you to believe that you're going to see greater things. That we're going to see greater things. If you believe the Lord, He'll show you greater things. Amen. If you believe God, you'll see what He said. If you believe the Lord, if you believe the Lord, that you'll find out that He loves you. That He truly loves you. In spite of everything He knows about you, He still loves you. I don't know about you, but I believe that. I believe that if He spoke it, I'm going to see it. I believe I'm loved in spite of who I am and who I am not. That's the love of God. That's what God can do for you. And I believe that greater things are on the way. I want you to believe the same way Andrew got Peter and Philip got Nathaniel. I'm coming for you. That's what I want you to believe. That's the love of God. I want you to open up your heart to Jesus. God has prepared you for this day to believe Him at His word. What did He tell the woman when she touched His garment? Your faith. You believed. So your faith has made you well. Do you believe that? Do you believe that God can heal you? Do you believe that greater things are yet to come? I want you to see the goodness of the Lord. The Bible says, taste and see that the Lord is good. So if you're here today, and I know you are, I want to extend this invitation to you. Maybe you're here today and you believed a long time ago, but life happened. Things happened. You found yourself maybe strained from the Lord. But how good is God? It's called the Holy Ghost setup. But today, you're here and your desire is to come back. Come back to God. You believe today and you're not in church. You believe today that this is a setup from God. You believe that. And your desire is to come back. This is also for you. Your discipleship, listen to this. Your discipleship is incomplete until you're in a place where you believe what God said. Did you hear that? Your discipleship is incomplete if you're not in a place where you believe God at His word. So today, my brothers and my sisters, I want to extend this invitation to those who God is speaking to. You're here, or maybe you're watching online. Jesus said, come. Come. Follow me. Let's all stand. Brother Victor, we can play some worship music. Let go. Hallelujah. You're here today. You're here today, and this word's for you. Come. Come, don't wait, don't hesitate, don't look to the left or to the right. Come. 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 Hallelujah. Come. Hallelujah. You're here today and you believe God can heal you. Come. I believe. I'm praying for a miracle in your life. The Bible says where two or more are gathered in His name, He's in the midst. If two or more believe. Hallelujah. 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 Anybody here want to stand in for somebody that knows that they need a healing? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You're going to be like the friends that lowered the guy through the roof. Hallelujah. You're going to stand in for someone that can't get there themselves. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. I pray right now.